In this video, we are going to go beyond graphs and we are going to start talking about statistical tests. Among other things, we will talk about why we need such tests and how not to use them. Let us say you want to tell whether there's a difference between two groups regarding a variable that you are interested in. For instance, you want to prove that boys are taller than girls in your university. How are you going to prove your point? The simplest way is to go and measure the height of a representative sample of the students. You compute the mean for girls, the mean for boys, and you display them both on a bar plot. If you really want to be rigorous and to visualize the diversity among boys and among girls, you compute the standard deviations and you add them in the bar plots as error bars. We assume here that you are familiar with the concepts of variable, mean, and standard deviation, by the way. So it is not strictly speaking needed to understand the rest of this video, but if it's useful to grasp the meaning of the graph that we are using. So once you have produced all the descriptive statistics like mean and standard deviation, and you have put error bars, what are you going to do? Are you going to compare the size of bars and say, hey, look, boys are taller than girls, case closed. But what if the difference had been a bit smaller? Look at the second graph. Here. Now I'm telling you, oh, actually the difference isn't that high after all. I say, there's no real difference. Then it is your word against mine, isn't it? Well, there must be a way to draw the line, a kind of threshold to decide in a non-arbitrary manner whether there's a difference or not. Well, this is exactly why statistical tests were invented. I'm not going to dwell here on the mathematical foundations of such tests, nor to define key concepts like the null hypothesis. There's plenty of content online if you want to go deeper into the subject. Just remember that there's a wide array of statistical tests and that you have to choose the test according to the nature of the variables you are studying. If you are comparing the heights of two groups, for instance, like in this case of the height of boys and girls, then you are going to use what is called the student's test. It's a form of ANOVA, by the way. You use these tests when the variable that you want to explain is continuous. Height is a continuous variable because it can take any value between, let's say, 1 meter and 2.5 meters. The next step is to look at what is called the p-value of the test, which is somewhere between 0 and 1. The closer to 0, the stronger the difference between your two groups. The closer the p-value is to 1, the less significant is the difference. So if you perform a student test and that you obtain a p-value of 0.00001, yes, there's a statistically significant difference between boys and girls. But if we get 0.1, what do we do? Is there some sort of threshold? Actually, yes, there is. It's 0.05. It's the threshold we used to say, in this case, there's a difference, and in this one, there's no difference between both groups. And the threshold is p-value of 0.005. When you're above it, we usually say it's not significant, and when you're below it, we usually say it is. What does it mean exactly? It means that if you reject the null hypothesis, or in other words, if you say that there's actually a difference between boys and girls, you have 5% chance of being wrong. This is what 0.05 stands for, and scientists usually accept the fact that 5% is an acceptable risk. There are lengthy debates over the relevance of the threshold of 5%, but we will not dwell on the matter here. Just remember that there's an indicator, the p-value, and that the threshold is usually 0.05. There's a trick, by the way. The smaller the error bars, the more likely it is that the p-value will be below this threshold. It's enough for the moment. So, shall we dwell a bit on a historical example? While browsing the internet, blogs, and YouTube channels for the sake of this course, I discovered a controversy that I believe is a perfect illustration of this video, the Reinhardt and Rogoff controversy. And most of what I'll say here and the other videos comes from YouTubers and bloggers. So this controversy is named after the authors of a now infamous research article published in the American Economic Review, Growth in the Time of Debt. You remember the financial crisis of 2008 and its consequences. And maybe you remember when politicians from all over the world imposed austerity and the decline of public services that ensued. Well, plenty of them were looking for a scientific way to legitimize pretty unpopular decisions. A And the article provided just that. The author aggregated data on public debt and growth of advanced economy, like Canada and New Zealand, for decades. After dividing situations in three groups, low, medium, and high levels of debt, they showed that there was for a high level of debt, the average growth of advanced economies was actually negative. And various politicians said that very serious research had shown that debt should be not go beyond 90% of GDP, otherwise growth would plummet. Well, the review it was published in was indeed prestigious, but for these issues, articles were not peer-reviewed, meaning examined and validated by other researchers, and editors trusted the reputation of the authors. Well, bad idea. In this article, they based all of their argumentation on visual comparison in a bar plot. No statistical test whatsoever. And if we did such statistical tests, there was not so many data to evidence to support the claims of this article that was cited thousands of times. Last but not least, they forgot crucial data while designing the graphs that they included in the research paper. But let's leave that for another video, shall we? These issues should never have happened in the first place, and it wouldn't have happened in a proper evaluation process. So the issues with the analysis presented in this paper were actually found by a student, by the way, who was trying to reproduce the results of the paper for an assignment, and led to this famous controversy. It is a perfect illustration of the fact that even if it's published in a famous review, you should not lower your guard. Now that you are more familiar with the notion of test, we'll try to go a step further. We'll discuss about the choice of the statistical test and the questions of the validity conditions of the test. Let's stop here for now. More often than not, a graph alone does not represent a sufficient proof to pinpoint differences and contrast, and they often ought to be backed up by statistical tests. This is the main takeaway of this video. If someone just presents the graphs when he should add a statistical test, you can just dismiss it.